Hello everyone, in this lecture let us see what is arc heating, what is a method employed in it, how it is going to work and what are the different categories in it, right? So coming to arc heating, first let us see the principle of arc heating. See, it is nothing but when you apply certain high voltage across the air gap between the electrodes and the charge to be heated, what happens is the air in the gap gets ionized. Why it is ionized? Because of the influence of electrostatic forces, and becomes this gap becomes a conducting medium. So when this current flows in the form of continuous spark, so that is nothing but we know what is it, it is called an arc. So when electrodes are made up of carbon or graphite, the temperature obtained can be in the range of nearly 3000 degrees to 3500 degrees centigrade. So the high voltage whichever is required for the arc to obtain, striking an arc which can be obtained by using a step up transformer which is to be fed from a variable AC supply. So this is the scheme of the arc heating. What we do, we supply very high amount of voltage to obtain high temperatures. So this medium between the arc or medium between the electrode and the medium to be heated, that is charge, must be getting ionized, right? So this arc, whatever is obtained, can we also be obtained by using a low voltage across the electrodes. Then what we do, across the electrodes, first we keep in contact both the electrodes and apply some low voltage, and when the current is flown between the current starts flowing between the two electrodes, we move those two electrodes far away, right? So that the arc will be stuck between these two electrodes also. This is a method of producing the arc between the two electrodes by using a low voltage. So to obtain this, we use a step down transformer, right? So by using either high voltage or low voltage, we can obtain the arc between the electrodes, right? Now coming to the methods of arc heating, here the classification is written, that is direct arc furnace and indirect arc furnace and submerged arc furnace. Now let us see what are these three methods in detail. So first, coming to direct arc furnace, you can see the constructional part here. So here is a heating chamber, right? So there are two electrodes and a charge in it. Charge is nothing but the material to be heated, right? So these electrodes are placed such that there is certain gap between these two electrodes and the charge body of the charge, right? So these furnaces, we can say these furnaces produces very high temperature, right? So to achieve this, we can use AC supply, right? So what is this concept? This concept is circular steel casting line, right? Inside with a refractory material. So here will be a refractory material such that there is no short circuit obtaining between the charge to be heated and this chamber, right? So that is called refractory material, which is nothing but a lining inside the furnace. So this roof, whatever it is, this is a roof, it is removable, right? If any case exists such that there is a damage inside or a blast inside, then you can immediately remove the roof of this chamber, right? This can be replaced. So it consists of the certain chambers to insert the electrodes also, right? So these electrodes may be constructed with the help of either graphite or carbon, amorphous carbon, right? So the graphite, if you see the conductivity of graphite, we know that it's double the conductivity of a carbon. So, and also it can carry 2.5 times of the current that can be carried by the carbon. So though the graphite material is costlier than the carbon, so graphite electrodes are usually employed, right? So also the amount of graphite electrode required is nearly about only 2/3 the diameter of the same carbon material to produce the same amount of heat, right? So though it is costly, we go for graphite material, right? So these are the advantages of graphite material over graphite electrode over the carbon electrode. Now we need to now an arc is to be produced between the electrode and the charge to be heated. So to heat this charge to certain level or the desired level, the amount of arc produced between the electrodes and the charge must be controllable. How it is controlled? Now the amount of heat that is transferred to this arc to this charge depends upon the length of the arc, right? To maintain the desired length of the arc, what is done is these electrodes are raised and lowered. It is risen up or lowered individually with the help of some electric motors which can be operated by automatic regulators. So by varying the distance between these electrodes, we can vary the length of the arc produced between the electrode as well as the charge to be heated. So the voltage between the steel and the electrodes may be nearly 40 to 145 volts. So the longer the arc, the higher the voltage required and the less the input of the heat to the furnace, right? So the arc must be as long as possible so that we can apply so that the amount of voltage applied is higher and the input of heat to the furnace is lower, right? So now input to this can be given in the form of either three-phase supply or two-phase supply. If it is a three-phase supply, you need to take three electrodes, and if it is a two-phase supply, you need to take two electrodes, right? Now a transformer will be set up near to the furnace to for the control of the voltage, whether it is voltage down or step down or step up. To control the amount of voltage supplied to the furnace, a transformer will be set up, right? This is about the direct arc furnace. You can see with the help of the arc produced between the electrodes and the charge, the amount of heat produced get transferred to the charge to be heated, right? So the usual size of this kind of furnace is nearly 5 to 10 tons, right? 5 to 10 tons. Right, so this type of furnaces are used for making alloys, right? Next, the coming to the advantage, one more advantage of this furnace is very pure product can be obtained by this method of direct arc furnace, right? So this is the reason why direct arc furnace, though it is costlier, though its initial cost is high, it is preferred. Operating cost is high, then also it is preferred. So this furnace can also be used for melting of metals. So indirect heating, so melting of metals. Right, but due to its high cost, it has restricted applications. Right, coming to the power factor, when it operates on three phase, so it operates at about nearly 0.8 lagging power factor. So this is about the direct arc furnace. Now coming to indirect arc furnace, so here the amount of charge to be heated is heated indirectly, as the name indicates. Now let us see how does it happen. Now in indirect arc furnace, an arc between the two electrodes is formed and the heat is getting transferred to the charge with the help of radiation, right? So why? Because there is no direct contact between the arc and the charge, the heat get transferred through radiation. So as the heat is getting transferred through radiation, we can tell that the efficiency of this kind of the arc furnace is very less. Why? Because there might be some loss of the amount of heat generated while the radiation is taking place, right? So here is a single phase indirect arc furnace, right? So by short circuiting the electrodes manually or automatically, we can produce certain amount of arc between the electrodes. So the heat from the arc and the refractory lining is transferred to the top of the layer of the charge. Right, refractory lining is what we saw, nothing but lining inside the furnace. So arc may be produced directly or indirectly. What is the meaning of directly or indirectly? So if high voltage is applied, then the arc may be formed directly. Otherwise, what we can do, we can take in contact both the electrodes, supply low voltage, and when certain amount of current flows, then you move back the electrodes so that an arc is stuck between those two electrodes, right? So that will be transferred. The heat is produced due to I square R losses of the arc, then that amount of heat will be transferred to the charge produced, right? So in this type of furnace, as there is no current passing through the body of charge, there is no stirring action. So that means whatever the charge is present at the top layer, that gets heated. But there is no heating of this charge which is present at the bottom. That means there is irregular temperature of the charge. So what we do, we use some external measures so as to stir the, what we say, charge, stirring action, right? So there is only possibility of the charge, heat of the charge to be transferred is by conduction inside the charge, right? So to obtain the mission of heating the complete charge equally and quickly, we use some external methods, that is, we stir this charge continuously with the help of some electric motors and grinders, so that this furnace will be continuously rotating, so that there is a mixing of charge inside the furnace, right? So this method of stirring or grinding, also we can say that increases the efficiency of the indirect arc furnace. Why? Because the complete charge will be equally heated as quickly as possible. So this is the method of indirect arc furnace. Now coming to the input that is given, so you can take single phase AC supply for this indirect arc furnace, right? Now how the power input can be regulated? So the power input can be regulated by adjusting the length of the arc, that is by moving the electrodes. So coming to the power factor, it is nothing but, it is nearly up to 0.85 lag. It works at 0.85 lagging power factor, and the capacity of the furnace is about 0.25 to 3 tons. So if you see that when compared to direct arc furnace, the capacity of indirect arc furnace is lesser. Why? Because its efficiency is lesser. Why? Because the heat transfer is happening through radiation, right? So these furnaces are mainly applicable for melting of non-ferrous material. So now coming to the advantages of this indirect arc furnaces. So when compared to direct arc furnaces, they have lower overall production cost. Lower overall production cost per ton when compared to direct arc furnaces. So also this indirect arc furnace is flexible in operation. Also the losses due to oxidation in indirect arc furnaces is low. So losses are less. So these are the advantages of indirect arc furnace. Now coming to submerged arc furnace, as the name indicates, it is submerged. That means one electrode is over the, what we say, charge to be produced, and the other one is nothing but the charge itself, right? That itself acts as an electrode, right? The number of electrodes taken from the roof depends upon the type of supply, whether it is single phase or three phase, right? So the control of power there in case of submerged arc furnace is controlled by varying distance between the electrodes as in the remaining two methods, or by varying the voltage applied to the electrodes also we can vary the voltage applied to the submerged arc furnace. So coming to the power factor, it works at 0.8 lagging power factor. So also these are used for ferro alloys, manufacture of ferro alloys, right? So this is about the arc heating. Hope you have understood the different types of arc heating methods. Thank you.